Good morning. Ooh, good morning. I have the mic. Okay, I'm going to give you the microphone. If you can introduce yourself, your advisor, and then I'll give you a two-minute go.
Thank you so much. My name is Elisabeth Lloyd, and I am advised by Dr. Robert Hickey in the Materials Science and Engineering Department. Right. Okay. Right at this moment, there are over 100,000 people waiting for a life-saving organ transplant. If they get their match, they're going to spend the rest of their lives on immunosuppressants because their bodies won't recognize those organs as their own. There is a better way. Doctors and scientists are looking to use tissue engineering to grow synthetic organs for the patients from their very own stem cells, so it will be a match. However, the greatest limitation to this is in the scaffold that's used to grow the tissues. This scaffold has to be an exact match for the target tissue, which means that it has to be, in general, very soft, very flexible, and very reversible to endure the conditions inside the body. However, current approaches using very synthetic chemistry, very complex chemistry, don't include the critical porous microstructure for those cells to actually grow. So they aren't useful as cell scaffolds. My research is looking into using a porous hydrogel to be this scaffold. We use a hydrophobic, hydrophilic, hydrophobic block copolymer, and when this is in contact with water, the hydrophobic regions will clump together to provide physical integrity, while the hydrophilic regions will pull water in, making a hydrogel. If you dissolve this block copolymer in water in solvent first, before injecting into water, the diffusion of the solvent creates a beautiful porous structure that is very similar to natural tissue. So this similarity is striking for a variety of reasons, because it is this porous microstructure that produces the properties that are so difficult to mimic. We see that we have extreme elongation, non-linear strain hardening properties, a super soft modulus, and near perfect reversibility, which are all hallmarks of natural tissues that are so difficult to mimic. So my research is looking into how we can tune this microstructure to one day have life-saving applications as a tissue engineering scaffold for artificial organs. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Dharani Abeysinghe. I'm a third year graduate student from chemistry department. My advisor is Dr. Christine Keating. Yes. Okay. As I stand here talking, about 100 trillion cells are working inside my body to keep me alive. What happens if some of these cells stop working due to some condition? Then I would be given some medication or a transplant at the worst. Yet, they do not always go as planned. About 15% of the transplants fail as the body rejects these foreign cells. What if we could use artificially designed cells that are custom made to match each person's body and their specific condition so that we could sort of trick the body into recognizing them as its own cells? This could be the future of personalized medicine with the use of artificial cells. They mimic natural cells, but they are made much simpler and customized for a specific cause. In my research, I introduced a new class of artificial cells called proteocells. I start by creating these cell-sized compartments using mini versions of proteins called peptides, and then I increase their complexity stepwise. We can think of this artificial cell as a manufacturing plant. Much like the walls of the building, I create an outer membrane which separates interior from exterior. It has pores which act like doors, regulating what enters or leaves the cell. Mimicking the machines you would see inside the plant, I encapsulate these molecular machines called enzymes. They give out our desired products. And then I introduce more compartments or artificial organelles to achieve division of labor. Like each specialized department of the plant, I can tune these compartments for different functionalities. Ultimately, these cells can be engineered to survive on their own, producing their own components on site. For example, one day, they could be specialized to produce anti-cancer proteins within tumors, achieving the impossible. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was perfect, right at 2 minutes.
Hi, everyone. I'm Aditya Sapre, a third-year chemical engineering graduate student. And I've been in this competition for the last 2 years. And after learning from failures, it's very exciting to stand here and give a pitch in the final round. So thank you for that. Do you know that out of 10,000 applicants, only 2 to 3 drugs get the final approval of launch after a long and stressful process? The major challenge in drug discovery is identifying the right protein from a mix of proteins that can bind with the right drug. Now, before I tell you how we tackled this challenge in our lab, let me introduce myself. I'm Aditya Sapre, a third-year chemical engineering graduate student. Now, most of the current techniques involved in protein screening make use of the physical properties of proteins, such as its shape, size, and density. This makes it difficult to harvest the right type of protein from a mix of proteins having very similar physical properties and in quantities that are enough for the tail end analysis. Now here, my channels come into picture, which are of the length of my forefinger, and subchannels present there are of the scale of 1/100th of a single grain of rice. So you can imagine how small these channels are. We pass a mix of proteins in these channels on one side and a candidate drug on the other side, where each type of protein is colored with a different dye. Now, as I or most of us move towards the delicious smell of freshly baked cake, these proteins also tend to move towards the right candidate drug and bind with it. Using these pure binding interactions, what we have shown is one type of protein separates itself from the mixture, and the detection technique that we use measures the intensity of the color that is present on the protein using UV light and helps us identify this separation. Now, most of the current techniques take about 12 to 18 hours for one single batch, and it uses larger volumes of proteins versus my technique just takes 30 minutes. It can work in a continuous way, and it uses the smallest volumes possible. So, after obtaining this data, we firmly believe that if scaled up to an industrial level, we will make the initial stages of drug discovery much faster and speed up the whole process and make it much more cost effective. I am Aditya Sapre, and this is my pitch. Thank you.
Hi everyone, my name is Yutong Liu. I'm a first year graduate student in chemistry department. I'm currently working at Professor Lauren Zardar's lab. So our group works on some physical chemistry and surface chemistry stuff. Yeah. So our research is about collective behaviors. Collective behavior, we use this term to describe the group behavior as a large number density of populations. Actually, they exist quite common in our nature if you observe in our daily life, like bird flocking, fish schooling, insect colonies, mammal herding, and at micro scale as well, like cellular slime molds. To understand these behaviors, chemists invent different kinds of microswimmers to mimic their behaviors. Like this one, they mimic the insect bridging through the leaves, and this one, they mimic the fish escaping from the sea lion. At the same time, theoretical scientists also use different theoretical models, simulations, trying to understand these behaviors from a physical perspective. One problem currently exists in this field is that we lack a bridge connecting these two fields. So our goal is to set up an easy operated chemical system which can provide feedback for the simulations. And we will set up a simulation, a collective behavior model to based on these feedbacks to explain these behaviors. So this is our chemical system. It's composed of water, oil, and surfactant molecule. Once the oil droplet is formed in the solution, it can move individually or interact with each other, either repelling or chasing each other. So actually, this chasing behavior just mimics the prey and predator interaction in our daily life. So based on this, this is our current result. One of the experimental results is on the right, and one of the simulation results is on the left. So you can see at a similar number ratio of the two species and size ratio of two species, they behave quite similarly from the simulations and from the experimental results. So we can say it's quite promising for our research right now, and we want to continue explore using different experimental data to improve our model and use model to provide
physical series for our experimental data. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I am Monalisa, and I'm a third-year graduate student in the physics department, and I'm an experimental physicist, and I work under Professor Junju. So, I can start. Did you know that the process of drug discovery can take 10 to 15 years and a substantial amount of the time is spent on identifying the potential drug candidates and studying their properties? Quantum computers, owing to its ability of calculating a number of parameters simultaneously, can drastically reduce the time frame. They can also solve complex problems in a matter of few days or even seconds, which would take any traditional computer the age of the universe to solve. Unfortunately, the qubits, which are building blocks of a quantum computer, are very fragile against environmental noise. They need to be protected in ultra-high vacuum cases, making the computation very complex and expensive. So this is where my research comes into action. We focus on a special kind of exotic 2D engineered material by fabricating them into devices and doing the low temperature current voltage measurements, we show that a material has the potential to realize a special kind of topological qubits which are very resilient against noise. But how? So imagine you take a bunch of threads and you weave them into a braid. You shake it. The braid remains unchanged. This is the same idea that topological qubits use. They encode information in that braid, or I should say, they store information in the topological properties of a material that remains unchanged on interaction with environment. For example, you take a coffee mug and you deform it into a donut. Although the structure has changed, their topological properties remain same. Researchers worldwide are engineering platforms to realize topological qubits because we strongly believe that this would be the best approach to realize a scalable, error-free quantum computer. Thank you.
And how about just a round of applause for the contestants? Thank you all very much.